Apple's Human Interface Guidelines shows you how to create the best user experience for apps on Apple platforms. It is a must-read for all iOS devs, and I'm willing to bet the majority of you out there have never even looked at it. Hell, some of you might not even know it exists. So in this video, I'm gonna give you an overview of the Human Interface Guidelines, or the HIG for short, and we'll dive into some specific examples, including some for building apps on the new Vision Pro. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. Here I am at the homepage of the Human Interface Guidelines, and I'm gonna bounce around a bit to give you an overview, but this does get updated all the time. As you can see, front and center, new and updated, right? All the visionOS stuff, and here's all the different sections and topics. But because it gets updated very regularly, I recommend as an iOS developer, you read through this at least once a year, probably around WWDC time, because that's when most of the updates happen. But you definitely just can't read this once and think you know everything. It's constantly updating. So as you can see on the left here, it starts with platforms and designing for iOS, iPadOS, macOS, visionOS, all that stuff. This will give you the big picture, like philosophy for that platform. And as we go deeper into like foundations and patterns, it gets pretty into the weeds. So an example of the big picture platforms, let's look at macOS. And if we scroll down a bit, it talks about how the display is much bigger than an iPhone or an iPad. So, you know, design your app accordingly. The ergonomics, usually you're sitting at a desk 1 to 3 feet away. You know, the inputs, you're using keyboards, a mouse, which is a lot more precise than, you know, a finger tap. So you don't necessarily need to have big fat buttons on a Mac app, and on and on, right? The best practices, you know, leverage the large display, let people resize, hide, show your window, use the menu bar, include keyboard shortcuts. All this, again, design philosophy for a macOS app. And there's the same thing for visionOS. Talk about the concept of space, windows, and volumes, and the concept of immersion in a visionOS app. So I'm not gonna, again, get into the weeds on this, but this section here, again, gives you the big picture design philosophy on a platform by platform basis. And as we go further down the outline on the left, now we're starting to get more specific. So for example, immersive experiences in visionOS talks about the big picture of immersion versus pass-through. And a lot of these pages will have little videos to really illustrate the point on what, you know, being fully immersed is in the visionOS, like what happens to your window, and then more details, more info on it. Again, this is just a summary. I'm not gonna dive into everything, but a bunch of best practices, right? Reserve immersion for meaningful moments in content. Not every task has to be fully immersed in visionOS. You know, offer multiple ways to use your app, right? Give them the freedom. Do they want to be fully immersed? Do they not want to? That's just immersive experiences. And even little things like an app icon, right? We kind of think of this as probably an afterthought, but that gets a whole page on best practices. As you can see, the app icon looks different on various platforms. How you should handle different levels of detail in your icon if it's going to be one of the smaller ones versus one of the big icons. And then when it comes to visionOS, well, this is the macOS app icons, there's a whole thing on that too, but I wanna get to the visionOS ones where there's three different layers. That gives it that 3D pop-out effect that we see here when I play, right? So you're gonna have to do your app icon differently. So again, even something like the app icon gets a whole Human Interface Guidelines. And let's keep going down the list on the left. Just a few more examples. You know, I don't want to beat a dead horse here, but let's go down to patterns now. Show you a couple examples of this. And you can see the whole list on the left here, but charting data. If you're building a chart with the new Swift Charts framework, you're going to get all kinds of best practices on how to design an effective chart. And what I like about the Human Interface Guidelines, as you're hopefully seeing, is that it's very visual, right? It'll tell you what to do, but also give you a visual to go along with that. And moving down the list here, another example, let's do playing haptics. I think the main point on like using haptics, they're really cool, you know, when you're using your phone, that little tap, tap, tap you get. But, you know, one of the main points is avoid overusing haptics, right? Because it's very easy to get carried away and put them everywhere, but also make them optional. Like let people turn off haptics because some people don't like them. And then let's keep going down the left here on some more common things, components, right? Like navigation and search. Let's look at the navigation bars. And here's all the best practices on using navigation bars, not only in iOS apps, but all the different platforms. VisionOS, WatchOS, it'll tell you how the nav bar will behave on WatchOS. Same thing with sidebars. This is a very common pattern, especially on like a iPad app, right? Use a sidebar to help them navigate. Let the user hide the sidebar. And then lastly, without, you know, beating a dead horse, there's, you know, inputs. With the Apple Pencil, I thought this was a cool one. All kinds of best practices on how to use the Apple Pencil, how to use the hover capability that's brand new. And that's why the Human Interface Guidelines is constantly changing, right? Because Apple is constantly releasing new features for their hardware or new features in the software. And you have to know how to use that new stuff the right way. There's gestures, keyboards, touch bar. The last one down here, technology, is really small, but you know, Apple Pay, CarPlay, basically any type of app you're gonna build, whether it's a camera app, CarPlay app, Maps app, right? Here's Maps, here's best practices on the Maps. The Human Interface Guidelines has you covered on the best way to build all this stuff so you have an amazing user experience in your app no matter what platform you're building for. And if you're here learning how to make a great user experience, you're probably building great apps. And it's a great idea to have a portfolio website to showcase your work. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio, blog, or personal website up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're all developers with the skills and the desire to build the web page ourselves, but I would argue there's an opportunity cost to your time. If you're an iOS developer trying to build a great product, a great app, maybe spending a lot of time learning the ins and outs of web development, responsive design, isn't the best way to spend your time. That's why I recommend Squarespace to build that personal website, the blog, your portfolio, or maybe a landing page for your app. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started. They handle all the analytics and the SEO for you. Again, it just saves you so much time so you can get back to doing what you want to do, and that is building iOS apps. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com to start your free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.